Okay, so welcome back to this morning session. So unfortunately, I have to say it's always my duty to wake you up, which I mean it's not that I like very much, so I apologize. And that's why we always try to do this kind of as smooth as we can. So let me always remind you which was the point we had yesterday. So now we passed to study the singularities of these surfaces which are parametrized by graph of multiple value function. And the idea of the study is a blow-up analysis. So we take a singular point, say x0. And then we try to focus on small scales around this singular point. So we consider R being then 0 and BR x 0. And then we apply an homotopy which sends BR at x 0 to B1. And what we would like to understand is if in this limiting process we may somehow simplify our objects in such a way to deduce something on the side of this singular set. So for example, if here we had singularities accumulating to x0, we'd like to understand if the same happens somehow here. And the hope is that the limiting profile of this blow-up is kind of simpler than the function itself. So let me do a kind of a parenthesis here. So this kind of analysis of idea of blowing up and studying singularities via blow up is typical in geometrical analysis. And it's also the way singularities are studied in codimension one. So when you have in the case of hypersurface, you perform the same transformation, and via the monotonicity formula, so the classical monotonicity formula, we get that the limit is a cone. So in the case of codimension one, we start from something which is kind of singular, then we blow up this picture and we get a cone. And here you see we have gained one dimension of symmetry. So the radial direction here is kind of prescribed. And via the Allard's theorem that Camillo showed you in the first week, we know that this cone is not flat, so it's not a plane. Because all the points where the excess was small, so where we were converging to a cone, were actually regular points. So we have such a picture. And starting from this consideration, you may try, and that's what is done, to analyze and understand the behavior of this singular set. So now what we are trying to do, it's kind of really the same. But the situation is a bit more complicated. So the classical monotonicity formula, which is the ratio between the mass of the current and the mass of the disk with the same radius, is not giving a meaningful information in this case. Because here, just blowing up in that direction, what we get is twice a plane. Because here we have seen in our model singularity, which was that complex variety, that we had a continuous tangent plane. And in the limit, we were getting a double plane there. So performing this same analysis is not giving us the right information. And indeed, what we started to do yesterday was to cook up a new monotonicity formula, which was the monotonicity of the frequency. So instead of looking in the usual ratio between the mass of the current and the disk, we look at this function, which was called my Arngren frequency function. which I remind you was the ratio between the energy of our parametrization divided by the L2 norm at the boundary. This quantity we showed yesterday was monotone, and now this one is the quantity we will use to somehow perform such a blow-up analysis. So let's first understand. So the first hour of today, which I mean will be kind of aimed to conclude this blow-up analysis, will play somehow everything will be based on the monotonicity of this formula, so to say. And let's understand which kind of rescaling we need to do. So in this case of codimension one, we were somehow rescaling isotropically in all directions, and then we were getting the cone, which was singular, so we were looking at this angle here somehow. In this case, I mean, if we rescale isotropically, we get a plane. So not any information on the limit. The way here we have to rescale is kind of anisotropically, so maintaining the structure of the parametrization. So we will rescale kind of vertically and horizontally in a different way. And the scale we choose is, so now I write UR for the blow up on the ball BR in Y. So this one will be, so horizontally the function will be scaled as R. But then we have to normalize vertically this function in a different way. And the way, I mean, to gain compactness for the parametrization, you have various different ways. I mean, one way could be to keep one of the norm fixed. And we will keep the energy fixed. So we renormalize here by the Dirichlet energy in Vr of x naught. And then you will see you have a scaling factor here, which is R to the M minus 2 divided by 2, if I'm not wrong. Yeah. So what we are doing is, horizontally, we look at scale R. So it's through this picture here that we are focusing on a ball BR. But vertically, we need to rescale our function in order to maintain a norm. And doing like this, you see that the integral in V1 of dUR is equal to 1. So what we are maintaining is the energy. Now, the first proposition we would like to see now is that actually we have compactness for this rescaling. So as for the limiting cones, we were able to say that this rescaling was converging as a current to something which is a cone. Now we would like to prove that these rescales do converge as function, so L2, but actually they will converge, we will see W12, to a limiting profile which has some extra symmetries. And that's what we prove first, or we almost prove first. So the first result we are going to see of the domain, so, or of the current, if you want. And N is our codimension. Okay, so the theorem, I mean, it's a theorem is too much for such a statement. Let's call it proposition. So we assume that U in W12, let's say B1 AQ, is de-minimizing. And then we assume some extra hypotheses. I mean, let's say that we focus on a point X0, which is a multiplicity Q points. So U of X0, but I mean, we assume 0, is Q times 0. And then let's assume also that this rescaling is always meaningful. I mean, of course, if at a certain point the energy is zero, this means that U is constant, and that's the only minimizer, it's regular. So we would not look, we're kind of ending issue there. So we may assume that the energy in BR is bigger than zero for every R. Bigger than zero. Okay, the conclusion. So then, there exists a subsequence U R K, say, and a function U, which is the limit in W12, B1, or let's say RM AQ, such that the following holds. And then we have, so the first conclusion is that U is still de-minimizing, and in B1 has energy 1, so it's not 0. And the other conclusion is that actually U is somehow simpler than a generic de-minimizing. It's what is called alpha homogeneous. That is, U of X is equal X to the alpha, U of X over modulus of X, where alpha is a number bigger than zero, and thus corresponds to the limit as R goes to zero of the frequency of U at R. So it's W12 log. So let me, I forgot to put there. So UK, URK converges to U in W12 log. So what does it mean for multiple value function converging strongly? So this one I have somehow to say. So this one means that we have convergence L2, so the distance between URK, U, L2 is going to zero, and we have convergence of the energies. So the integral BR of the BL of the URK squared converges to the integral of the U in BL squared for every L. So we have convergence of the functions and convergence of the energy.
So the original function is U, and then U also denotes the limit, right?
And that's very bad, yes. So let's call this as in the notes, is G. Okay. Okay, thanks. So, but what is important here is that in the end we have a dear minimizer, G, which is non-trivial because the energy is 1, and we simplified our geometry of such surface. So for the minima cone it was linear, so it was here with alpha equal 1. Now we cannot claim that alpha is equal 1, but we have still something which is homogeneous of degree alpha, where alpha is exactly the frequency of our original function. So this one plays exactly the role of of the blow up for the condensation one case. So let's see a sketch of the proof of this proposition. So let me see what we can skip. So that's a proof, but won't be complete. So what we need to observe, so first of all, is that we would like to say that we have compactness for this UK. So let's check which properties has this function. So we start noticing that, so that's, I mean, we have said already before, the energy of this URK are all equal to 1. And then we know that we were blowing up a point of multiplicity Q, which in this process is fixed. So all these functions at 0 has values Q0. So now, by the continuity theorem, we knew that all these functions, which are de-minimizing on the ball B1 with bounded energy, they are uniformly order continuous, because the order norm was bounded by a constant, which was proportional to the energy, to the square root of the energy. So by the order continuity result, URK are uniformly continuous. So UR, we still to take a subsequency. Then up to taking a subsequence, we can find a converging sequence. Say, so in the uniform norm, but let's say in L2, it's enough somehow. Okay, this one seems quite standard, but I mean, let me say that here a few details are missing in this argument. So what is missing is that we have just verified that the energy in B1 was bounded, and the order continuity result is true in the interior. So in principle, we should say that this convergence is in the interior. But if you look carefully at the monotonicity formula of the frequency, you see that you have a bound of the energies at every scales, one with the other, which is a corollary that I should have put in the notes somewhere. It's a very simple consequence of this of the computation we did for the frequency. So actually, not just the energy B1 are equibounded, but the energy in all the balls. So here I could put BL, and here a constant. And this one remains still true. So now I can apply somehow this compactness in any ball smaller than BL. So meaning that up to subsequence, I have convergence locally in Rn. So this one, this argument is missing somehow this point here. But you find this in the note. And now a point which is missing is which I won't prove here, but again I put in the note, is that and that's also is kind of a very standard argument in calculus of variation, which has to do with a concept which is called gamma convergence, is that when you have a sequence of minimizers and some properties, of course, of your minimizers, you converge to a minimizer. So the claim is that our limit, G, so converging subsequence in L2 towards G. So the claim is that our limit G is de-minimizing. So it's still a minimizer of our function, and I have the convergence of the energy, which is what I claimed here. And the convergence of the energy also. So you may see this as a consequence of a very general principle, but actually the proof I gave in the notes is self-contained and quite simple. So you know, you may assume that one of these two conclusions is not true. So this means that in the limit, G may miss, either G decrease the energy of your sequence, or G being not minimizers, you may find another function which decreases the energy with respect to G and the boundary value of G. But then since you have convergence in L2, you may select a good slice where you have the convergence of the slice. And this means that the competitive function for G, which was improving the energy for G, it's also improving the energy for the sequence. And this one cannot be, because our sequence were a sequence of minimizers. So this one I won't prove. You find all the details in the note. But it's a very standard. It's kind of the same conclusion is for the theory in codimension one, that when you have a sequence of minimal currents, they converge to a sequence of minimal currents, and the mass is continuous. So the only thing now I would like to verify, and what is important for us, is this point two, so the structure of the limit. Why we can conclude that the limit has this extra symmetry. And for doing this, we look at the frequency of the limit. So now the limit is a de-minimizer. So all the conclusion about the frequencies we had yesterday still holds for G. And now we see what is the frequency for G. So and we compute this frequency in zero. So this one we say is R, the energy BR of dG squared divided by the L2 norm of G squared. And now, first of all, we know that we have uniform continuity for the UR to G, and then we have continuity of the energy. So we can write this in terms of a limit with respect to the UR. So R BR du RK squared divided by the L2 norm of the boundary of URK squared. And now UR was just a rescaled function with respect to U. So if you perform here the change of variable back, you obtain this formula. So R RK integral in BR RK of du now squared divided by the L2 norm in this balls of U squared. But this one is nothing else than the frequency of U at the radius R, RK. R going to zero of E of U at R, RK. Which, I mean, we know this quantity was monotone and was converging to the limit, which we called alpha. And now you see, we have that for G and for a given R, so this one is a limit RK, sorry. For G and for a given R, the frequency is always alpha. So the frequency of G is constant. And we argued yesterday that this one can happen if and only if G is homogeneous. Okay, and now the last conclusion. So why alpha is bigger than zero? Now comes from here. This was a question also left open yesterday. Why alpha now is bigger than zero? Assume alpha is zero. We would have that G now is zero homogeneous. So meaning that it's constant on the radii. But it's continuous, and in the center, G has value zero. So this would be that the only possibility for alpha being zero is that G was zero. But G had an energy which was not trivial, because it was 1 in B1. So this cannot happen. And we conclude also that actually alpha was positive. Okay, so what so here it's kind of hidden what I told you yesterday. But basically, using this monotonicity of the frequency, we deduce that in the limit, via this suitable rescaling, which maintains the norm, the energy of the function, we obtain something which is not trivial, because the energy of G is still 1, and which is radially symmetric. Not really as a cone with the power 1, but as a power of the radius. And now we start from here, and we see how this first blow up has kind of simplified our situation, because now, if in some sense we are able to say that in this first blow up limit we don't lose track of the singularities, then somehow we may directly argue with something which is already radially symmetric. So, and that's what we do next. So now we come really to the core of the matter, and we start the proof of the estimate on the singular set for such function. Well, let me see if I forgot.
Maybe I overlooked completely, but I mean, there are very good reasons why you would scale up, and it's probably great from where did you enter the estimate?
On the frequency?
In the frequency. I don't know, where did it enter it? On the frequency?
Yeah, here, for example. All right.
So for the energy, you normalize for any output.
Yes, which, I mean, by the way, it's not. It's not the only thing you may do. So, for example, for the proof in the case of currents, we normalize for the L2 norm of the function. And still, I mean, since the frequency is telling you that these quantities are all comparable, you may conclude. So it's not the only thing you may do. Now, in this case of functions, it's very elementary doing like this. But, for example, already for currents, we do something different. Okay, so let me now proceed with the main part of the proof of the argument. So now we come to the proof of the main theorem, which was, I give you a de-minimizing function, and I would like to see that the singular points are of dimension m minus 2. So now we try to prove that the dimension, the out of dimension of the singular set of U is less or equal than m minus 2. And I claim that somehow the core of the matter is this is this lemma here. So lemma, which is, I mean, it's sort of equivalent to the theorem, but so the core of the matter is this: is to give an estimate on the set of points of higher multiplicity. So I set, let's say, sigma q, the point x in our domain, such that u of x is equal to q times the point p, for some p in Rn. And q is the maximum multiplicity, because we assume that we are a q covering of our domain omega, always. And the claim is that then either this set is the entire omega, so which means that u actually was q times a regular harmonic function, in which case we have no singular sets, or the out of dimension, so the dimension of this set is at most m minus 2, and is countable or even discrete when m is equal to 2. That's a, so this one is the analog of this theorem here, in the case where we just look at the points of multiplicity q, of higher multiplicity. And once you can prove this, so you may understand the singularities of the higher multiplicity points, then you may argue by induction to prove the theorem. So the proof of the theorem is kind of by induction on the number of values q. So when q is equal to 1, of course there is nothing to prove. We have just, so the basic case, everything is regular, so the singular set is empty. And that's because u is harmonic. And now we assume that we know the result for every q less than a q star. So assume the proposition for q less than q star. And then we want to prove for q star. P there? Yeah. So P is a point in Rn. Okay. So it's equal to this for some P in Rn. So there are points where all the leaves of the function are collapsed into one point. This one? Yeah. No, this one is one value. So when you have one value, nothing to be discussed. Because one, yeah, exactly, over omega. So what we have is that omega is our domain, and here we have two values. So when the value is one, there's nothing to discuss because it's a maximum one. It's harmonic. And now we assume to know this result for any q less than a given one, and then we prove for this new one. And now what we take is so we consider our set sigma q. And now two things may happen according to this proposition. Either sigma q is the entire domain. In that case, I mean, there is no singular set. Everything is a q copy of an harmonic function. Or the sigma q has dimension m minus 2. So if this one is the entire set, then the singularities of u are empty, and we are happy. So we can assume that the dimension of this sigma q is less or equal than m minus 2. And now it's very simple to see. So the function is continuous. This set is defined by an equation. So this set is closed. So now we can consider the complementary set. So since sigma q is closed, consider the open set omega minus sigma q. And now what happened in omega minus sigma q? That locally, so we have no maximal multiplicity, our function is continuous. This means that locally we can split our function over this set. So let me make here a picture. So in case of two or even three points. So here sigma q is just these points here. So now q here is equal to 3. And this one is the only point of multiplicity 3 that I have. Outside of this point, I am always able to split my current in the graph of my function in different packets, so to say. So for example, here I have actually three different leaves, but I may have also a situation like this. So around this point here, I'm just able to split the current in two blocks, where one is a one-valued map and the other one is a two-valued map. But anyhow, what I know is that locally, so for every x naught in outside of this maximal multiplicity set, there exists r bigger than zero such that u in the ball br x naught is equal to the sum as measure of a function u1 and u2, which are de-minimizing, and are qi valued functions with qi less than q star and q1 plus q2 equal q star. So at least I find two blocks. So for example, a two-valued block and one block, where the multiplicity is strictly less than the maximum one, because I'm away from the maximum multiplicity point. They are still minimized because being continuous, they are just isolated on a very small scale, which is arbitrary here. And the sum of these values, of course, is the total value of the covering. So above each ball here, we have exactly the superposition of two functions, which falls in this case here. They are de-minimizing and q-valued for some q that is less than q star.
Sorry, here the u is the q-valued or q star value?
Q star, because now we are trying to prove this for...
Q star, sorry.
The maximum multiplicity here is Q star. Yeah, thank you.
But then why can we assume that the measure of sigma Q star less than equal to M S2? Because that's what we want to prove.
That's the content of our proposition. That if I take the maximum multiplicity, yeah, then this set with the maximum multiplicity satisfies this conclusion here. So now, for this one?
Yes.
And this one is this conclusion here, the conclusion of the proposition.
So you're not proving the proposition, you're proving
the theorem. Oh. Yes, oh, sorry. Okay. That's the proof of the theorem assuming the proposition. So let me repeat this. I mean, now I hope it's completely unclear. So let me repeat this and fix the notation. So the proposition says that when I take the maximal multiplicity, then this set is either the entire domain or as dimension m minus 2. And in this proof, the higher multiplicity is q star. So let's put also the q star here, so there is no confusion about this. So the proposition claims this second line here, or these first two lines, that either we are exactly a superposition of the same function, so Q star times the same function, or we are very small in measure. So that's what he's claiming by the proposition. Assuming this, I'm proving the theorem by induction. So assuming that we are now in this situation here, outside of this set, so now this one is Q star, I may be able locally to decompose in simpler functions. And once I decompose in simpler function, I apply the inductive hypothesis. So now what I know is that the singular set of U1 and the singular set of U2 has dimension at most m minus 2. And now you may argue via a simple covering argument. So this one is an open set of this bounded domain. So for each point in this open set, you have a ball where the singular set has the right dimension. Then you cover with countably many of them, and you have that all the dimension of the singular set, which is the one for each packet in each ball, plus this one has dimension at most, m minus 2. So now, by simple covering, we conclude that all the singular set of U has dimension. At most, m minus 2. So the proof of the theorem is really, what I'm saying is that via this very simple induction argument, the theorem is actually reduced to look this property for the higher multiplicity points. That's really what matters, because the rest may be treated by induction, because we reduce the complexity of our problem. So all the effort should be done somehow to prove this theorem here. So that was just very quick, but I mean, again, in the notes you find all the details to say that the core of the proof is estimating the higher multiplicity points. That's all. And now let's come to this point of the higher multiplicity where we meet another of the main analytical issues of this theory, which, as for the others, I would like to explain you via an example. And now, this issue may be called kind of centering. So, yeah. Can you repeat, please? So that the singular set of U in this ball BR of X naught is equal to the union of the two singular sets. So it's the singular set of U1 union the singular set of U2. This means that U has not singular set on that ball. No, I'm saying U in the ball BR of X naught, because U1 and U2 are just defined on this local ball. So when I have two values, I'm not looking at these points here, because this one is a point of higher multiplicity. So this one is my sigma Q, in this case sigma 2, and I'm looking at the point here. And here, actually, my U, like my U1 and U2, are completely regular. On the other hand, if I have three values, so this one will be sigma 3, and I look at this point here, this one is a singular point for U, and it's a singular point for one of the two functions, say U1. So the singularities of U are exactly the union of the two. And this one you verify easily from the definition of singular points. Okay, so let's leave this here for a while. And let me start in this kind of last chapter of this story. So now we reduce to consider the higher multiplicity points, but still we have a problem with what I told you about the persistence of singularities. So we would like to say that when we perform our blow-up, if I have a singular point, I remain with the singular point. Which means for currents, it's not that easy, and there is no this correspondence. For functions, it's a bit simpler, but there is kind of a very key analytical issue behind this. So this one, I mean, we can say it's a problem on the persistence of singularities. And one of the issues was this frequency, that, I mean, we don't have to collapse to zero, because otherwise we lose all the singularities. But there is another issue which is somehow connected with the centering of the leaves of our functions, which says that, I mean, even if we do not collapse to zero, we may still lose all the singularities in the limit. That may still happen. And for understanding this, as usual, let's consider an example. So I may take the same here in the notes. So I take an example of a complex variety. As usual, it's both an example of a minima current and of a deminimizing function. And this complex variety, I called the first one V, this one we call W. We take the point Z, W in C2, such that, let me maintain the same notation here, W minus Z squared equals W to the final. So in the notes, I gave all the formal way to express this formula. Here, the blackboard, let's do like informally. And informally, I'm saying that, so this one is a Z. Informally, I'm saying that W is equal to Z2 plus or minus the 2 square root of Z to the fifth. So the 2 determination of the square root. So that's if I solve this equation in W. Roughly speaking. So when I try now to draw a picture, what I get is this. That at the first order, I'm looking at the solution of W equal Z squared, which is this function. So that's W, Z. So at the first order, I have this picture here, which is a very smooth embedded disk. So this one is a very regular surface. But then I'm branching on this surface. So the real calligraphical W, which is the yellow one now, it's a branching on this. So this one is a complex curve, which is not smooth in the origin, because I have the same phenomenon of a branch point. But I'm not branching, I mean, around the z-plane, like in the first one. But I'm branching around this smooth disk, which is this W equals Z squared. So that's the picture that I have for this complex curve here. And now you may try to do the blow-up by yourself for this function. When you do a blow-up here with the formulas I gave you, and I mean, actually, I invite you to do this exercise, you verify that you converge to this function here. So you converge as a blow-up to the smooth curve Z squared equal W. There is no way. Just take your formulas. Rescale center. Here you can do all the computation explicitly. Pass it to the limit, you obtain this. as what? As a two-dimensional, as a two-valued function. So this one will have multiplicity two. This so you convert to a double copy of this disk, which is an embedding disk. So we started from a singular point here. We perform our blow-up. We don't have any more singularities. So we can understand nothing about from the blow-up for such a function. So what is here the problem? The problem is that these minimal surfaces may have a regular part, which we have somehow to mod out in this blow-up limit. So somehow here the best would be not to see this as a function over the z-plane, because what we see in the limit is just the first order part, which may be kind of perfectly regular. But the best would be to see this w as a function over a kind of centered manifold. So to change coordinate, find what is called after Amgren centered manifold, which in this case is exactly this smooth disk. So it's actually a very smooth manifold. And then look at W as a parametrization on the normal bundles of this center manifold. So the main idea here would be, okay, just performing a blow-up analysis, we may not be sure that the first order of our surface is a singular order. Because something like this may happen. This one is an example of a minimizing surface. What we should do is somehow mold out this first order, which is regular, kind of finding this first regular part of the surface, and then just looking at the singularities over this manifold, which is a very nice and smooth manifold. So the idea here would be, so in this picture now I change a bit. So I don't look this on the normal bundles. I mean, for function, it's not necessary. But I may look this kind of vertically parameterized on this. I mean, for minimal currents, you would have to go to the normal bundle. But here, it's not necessary. So the best here is, OK, instead of taking z squared plus or minus this square root, I just subtract my center value. So I don't take this, but I look and a new map, which sends z not to, so not this, z to z squared plus or minus z square root 5 over 2, but I just subtract this middle sheet. So I look at a function, which is f, which sends z into plus or minus z 5 over 2. So what I do is I modify my minimizer, parameterizing it not with respect to z, but with respect to this middle sheet here. So that's, I mean, for functions is what is going to work. Technically, it's very simple, but geometrically, it's a key point of the story. So in order to have this kind of persistence, of singularities, we have to subtract the average of the values. So what we consider is not u, but we have to consider the function f of x, which is the sum on all the values of what? Of the values of u minus their average, which we call eta composition u. So with eta composition u of x, which is just the function given by sum of ui of x divided by q. And this one now it's a function from omega to Rn. So it's a classical function. So what we do is exactly what I've pictured in this, I've drawn this picture, is that instead, so here, for example, the two values of u are z plus the square root, z minus the square root. So in this case, the average of u is exactly z squared. So this one is the exact average. And then we take as a function the values of u minus z squared, which are exactly these two. So this general formula is what I did for this example here. So,
you mean the blow up limit is such a surface, but like before, the limit of that is also a smooth one with multiplicity?
No, the other one was not a smooth one. That one, the isotropic limit. But if you do the rescaling I introduced for the blow up, you remain with the same function in that case.
The same?
Yes. So let me say, in the other example, which was, I don't remember now which, let's say Z3 equal W2, in which case, I mean, you see something like this. So let's put here W, here Z, and then you have this multiple value function here, so which now correspond to this. So you send z to the 2 square root of z3. So when you do the blow up of this u, you are constantly equal to u. So when now you do ur with the formulas I gave you, so which was, now it's two-dimensional, so it's just the dilation divided by its energy on BR square root. So this one is just a multiple of U. So it's just a constant times U. That's another computation you may do. Because it's not an isotropic blow up, in which case you are right, you get a flat plane with multiplicity 2. But this blow up is scaling horizontally and vertically in different ways. And if you verify, this one is just maintaining the branch points of U up to a multiplicative constant, which is the one which is making U with energy 1. In this case, U has not energy exactly 1. You have to renormalize by its energy. So this constant is exactly equal to the energy of U in B1. So that's what you see in this plot for every car. So actually, you get something which is fixed there. So this phenomenon is kind of genuinely new. So you may still converge to something which is not trivial with energy 1, but all the singularities may collapse. So that's a... that's something we have to deal with. Okay, and the general solution in this special case of parametrizations is this. Just subtract the average. And why this works? Because the average is a very, very smooth manifold. That's due to the linearized behavior of this function. Because what you can prove very easily, and I leave to you as an exercise, is that if U is de-minimizing, then the average of U is harmonic. So that's the first thing. So U was solving this generalized Laplace equation, but the Laplace equation is linear. So when we average all the values, we get a classical function, vectorial function. This one is harmonic. And the other thing you may prove is that if U is de-minimizing and we subtract on some anharmonic, then we get something which is still minimizing. Then f of x, so that formula there, which are the values of U minus its average, this one is still de-minimizing. It's a very simple integration by part computation. So not just the average is harmonic. So this middle manifold, this center manifold, is an analytic manifold. It's very smooth. Not just this, but when we perform this operation of translating our values, we end up with something which is still a solution of our problem. And I mean, nothing to say this one maintains all the singularities of U. So now that's just a simple observation that the singular set of F is equal to the singular set of U, but the Q multiplicity point for F now are just the points where F is equal to zero. So within this operation, we simplified a bit more our set of higher multiplicity points. And not just the one with higher multiplicity, but exactly the one taking multiplicity Q zero. So they are all, so now with this translation, the singular points are all on the horizontal lines. So in some sense, when it's now very simple to understand that when we perform our blow up, having that everything collapse into a sheet means that everything should collapse to zero, because the only higher multiplicity leaves is the one at zero level. But we cannot collapse to zero because of the estimate on the frequency. So somehow subtracting this averaging take into account this problem of collapsing everything into a single leaf. Because the only possibility would be zero, but zero is not allowed by the frequency estimate. So I'm a bit late, so let's do just 5 minutes break, meaning that we resume in let's say 8 minutes, at 9:45, and then we conclude this this proof. So now we really come to the final argument of the proof. So something on the blackboard will be missing, but you have in the notes anyhow. And now we will do the proof of the proposition. So, which is, let's write in its simpler form the dimension of the multiplicity Q points less or equal than M minus 2. And we will do this proof in a simplified case. So the case, so we consider the case M equal to. The case M bigger than 2 is just a bit more technical, but if you know sufficiently some machinery, in geometric measure theory, it's anyhow very standard. It's very similar to the case M equal to. And in this case, we prove something slightly more. Not just the dimension is zero, but we prove that sigma Q is made of isolated points. So that's what we are going to prove, or to give the sketch of the proof in dimension two. And the proof now is it's kind of very standard scheme in geometric measure theory. So what you have a singularities. You assume that the singular set is very big. In this case, for example, we have an accumulation of other singular points towards it, and then we blow up it. So let me just recall. So this one is the set of X such that F of X is equal Q times zero. Did I assume Q equal two or not? I think no. So this one is this set here, and without loss of generality, we may assume that zero is a point on this set. So zero is a singular point that we try to understand if we can have accumulation towards zero. The proof is by contradiction. So by contradiction, we assume that there exists xk in sigma q accumulating to zero. So on this part of the blackboard, let me do a picture. So we have zero, which is a singular point. And then we have this xk, which may accumulate towards zero. And they are all singular. And that's what we would like to exclude. So we assume this. And the operation we do is the following. So we blow up at the radius, which is the distance of xk to zero. So this one will be our balls for the block, and so on. So we set RK equal norm of XK. So let me verify. Yeah. So, and now we consider our risk function. Let's just call for simplicity fk of y. So to change variable, that's f of rk y divided by its energy. Which, I mean, let me write in a concise way. Yesterday we write d for the energy. So d rk 1 half. Okay, that's the Dirichlet energy in the ball, brk. Okay, and look now at these functions here. So we know by all the previous stuff that up to subsequence we are converging to a deminimizing G, which has norm 1, average 0, and so on. It's not trivial. But let's look now at the pointwise behavior of this G. So what we are doing is we take this point, which is points Q times 0, and we send into radius 1. So this ball here is sent into B1. And I have here the corresponding radius, which is xk divided by its norm. So it's a point in S1, where the function has value Q times 0. So here, fk of this point is equal to Q times 0. And we know already that everything is converging in the uniform norm, because everything is uniformly order continuous, because the energies are all one. So we have here a limit of points where the value is 0. So if we consider now S1 is compact, if we consider up to subsequences W the limit of xk divided by its norm, which are points in S1, then by uniform convergence, the limit, so g is converging, fk is converging uniformly, the points are converging, so the limit at this value is exactly q times 0. So we have, now let me, this one was the extra conclusion I wanted to deduce. So collecting all the conclusions, we have G from B1 to AQ is deminimizing and it's not trivial. So the energy of G is 1. And since they were all functions with average 0, it's very simple to see that also they are converging uniformly, so also the average of G is 0. So G is made of values which sum up to 0. 3, we have that G is alpha homogeneous. That was one of the conclusions of our blow-up analysis. And finally, we know that we have a point on the boundary of S1 where G is 0. So G of 0 is equal to G of W is equal to Q 0 for some W in S1. And now I show that starting from these four conclusions, we have the contradiction. And for doing this, we do again something which is very classical in geometric measure theory, which is called cylindrical blow up. So the first blow up is around the singular points, and now we blow up off the line of the singular point. So the picture there is the following. So in the limit, we have a function g living here, and at a certain point w, which is the accumulation point of this boundary value, we have value 0. But now g was alpha homogeneous. So all this line here, it's a line of points of 0. And that's what I've been saying since a while, that G has simplified our picture. So starting just from an accumulation of singular points, in this limit we get, because of this homogeneity, we get all these lines of zeros. And now we make a blow up at a point here of lines. So we just consider this second blow up, which is called cylindrical blow up. So by the way, all of this is done also in codimension one, when instead of these blow-up maps, we have the tangent cones. So this one is very standard, somehow, in knowing a bit of machinery in geometric measure theory. So we make this cylindrical blow-up around, say, W over 2. So we take, let's give another name, Rs of y equal g w over 2 plus sy divided by the square root of the energy around s w over 2 dg squared 1 half. And now here comes a technical lemma I don't want to show at the blackboard, but I can give you an intuition for this lemma. So every time you have something which is kind of radially homogeneous, so it's invariant somehow on the radii, and you blow up not in the origin, so at the middle of one of this radii, you get something which has a symmetry which is cylindrical, and that's why it's called cylindrical blow up. And you have to think like this. So this radii close by to the yellow one, as you get closer and closer, are kind of parallel, and much more parallel. So when I blow up here, the picture is basically making all these radii straight. So when now from here I do this second blow up, I get such a picture here. And this middle one is always the yellow one. So here there is really nothing deep. Just take the formulas, write the limit of these functions. Remember that G was already radially symmetric, and you see that what you get is to have an invariant direction. So these functions here, up to subsequences, are converging to a function H, which is a function of one variable. So without loss of generality, put coordinates such that this point W was actually in one, what you get in the limit is that H of X is just a function of X2. So you have the invariance in the direction H1. But this one is still a blow up. So it has all the properties of the blow up. So in particular, we have that. Now H, so let's talk about H, which is the entire function, but it's just a function of one variable, but H is de-minimizing. Its energy, it's non-trivial, so its energy is one in the right ball. Has still the average, which is zero, and is homogeneous. But this one, I mean, we may forget. So what is important is that we have taken the blow up at the point where the function was zero. So in the origin, H is still zero. So now let's make a picture of this. And now we look just this section, because this function is just described by H bar. And I make the picture here. So now we have a function which is so how can draw this picture? We have a function which is invariant in one dimension. So let's draw just the picture of H bar. Okay, maybe it's better. So for H bar, we have this one is the E2 dimension. In zero, we are zero. And then we know that it's not trivial, so it's not constantly zero, and its average, it's zero. So I have basically a number of values which balance to zero, which sum up zero. So if Q was equal to 2, H was looking like this. So each value was plus or minus. So H bar of X 1 is equal to minus H bar 2 of X, if the values are 2. Or otherwise, they really sum to 0, if they are more than 2. But now, this picture is quite a simple picture to analyze. So we have function which is 0 in the origin, and is one dimension. And that's to minimize the Dirichlet energy. That's a very instructive exercise. That the only one-dimensional minimizers are the linear function. That's kind for the minimal surfaces. The only minimizers are segments in R. So But not just segments in 1D are segment, but as for minimal surfaces, you know that if you have a minimizer, a one-dimensional minimizer, they cannot be two intersecting segments. So they are not intersecting segments. So that's kind of the minimal connection between points in Rn. That one is done for the area, but it's the same for the energy. And I invite you to verify this as an exercise. So when you have to connect a few points, and let's say we have a boundary given by this order here. So this and this, you have to connect with this and this. You know that this one is not a minimizer for the length, but the only minimizer is this. So, because you reduce the length of the two segments. And the same is true for the energy. So now we have, at the boundary, a number of points here. And the only way to minimize such an energy with this given boundary condition is to build segments which are not intersecting one with the other. But they should all pass through zero, and this one gives the contradiction. So since, but they all pass through zero, through the origin, we have the contradiction. Okay? So this one is the end of the proof. So let me repeat somehow this scheme. Was a bit fast, but I wanted to save some minutes for discussion. So the proof is like this. So we do our first blow up in the hypothesis when we have accumulation of singular points. This first blow up is putting us in a very favorable situation where we have still a minimizer, so a solution of our problem, and now we have an entire line of singularities. And what we do, now we do an offline blow up, and then we get something which is cylindrical. That's really where we see the reduction of the complexity. So we had this radial kind of homogeneity, which is already a reduction of complexity because it induced this cylindrical decomposition. So we lost one dimension, and we have now to discuss a problem which is a one-dimensional problem. But the one-dimensional problem is completely characterized. The only minimizers are non-intersecting segments joining the points at the boundary. But in all these conditions, zero was a singular point. So zero remains a point in all of these segments. The only possibility is that the segments are all the same, which is not possible, because having all the segments the same and being balanced to zero means to be zero. So that's how we get the contradiction. And now, in any dimension, it's kind of the same. You blow up to the point that you reduce to the one-dimensional case. But you have somehow to work out with a arguing with the dimension of this set in terms of Hausdorff mesh, Hausdorff dimension, and so on. So this one completes, in some sense, what I wanted to present to you in terms of details of this analysis of these singular points. So which is, I mean, it's deeply different already in the geometry, in the result from the codimension one, because you don't see For each singular point, you don't see a singular cone, but you see something which has a continuous tangent plane. In order to analyze this continuous tangent plane, the great achievement of Amgren was to introduce all this machinery of multiple value functions and to discover this new Montonicity formula, from which then everything was derived. So first of all, let me ask you if you have a question about this part here. I mean, of course, I will stay here also next week, so we will have also time to discuss when you have digested a bit more all this material. You can have weaker assumption. So in the derivation of the monotonicity, we never used the minimality property of the function, but just the first variation. So if you have a function which satisfies the first variation, then that quantity is monotone. But all this theory is not working just for stationary maps, because in a couple of points we heavily used the minimizing property of U. So getting this strong convergence, we always have to argue via minimality. And also this last argument is an argument which uses the minimizing property of stuff, because two crossing lines are stationary. As very for this map, I mean, you may show by yourself. So also here we, in some sense, in several points we use kind of heavily the minimizing property, not for the monotonicity of the frequency.
The result, the statement of the result is
that it's not known. I mean, or let's say, I mean, it depends. I mean, what you consider as a statement somehow. I mean, that's so when you have two intersecting planes, so you have as I mentioned one singular set, so it is a stationary surface. So if you just ask for stationarity, depends on the notion also of stationarity you consider, you have probably to allow for bigger singular sets. That's but you may kind of refine a bit this notion, but it's not very natural. Okay, if you don't have other questions about this, the last 20 minutes, I would like just to discuss with you a bit what happened for the nonlinear problem. So we did everything now for this linearized equation. So we considered the Dirichlet energy, and everything was working perfectly nice. So we had this exact monotonicity. Everything was already parameterized as a function, so we could have used all these PDEs arguments, e-bendings, Moré estimates, and so on. Now, of course, without giving any details, which actually, at the beginning, was part of the plan. So you find in the notes the last chapter with some details for the nonlinear equation. Let me, now skipping these details, just telling you what is the end of the story. So this one is proving the analogous of this partial regularity resulted by Hamilton, this very special case of parametrization minimizing a Dirichlet energy, which corresponds somehow to the linearized equation. But then from here to the end of the story, it's a quite long road. And what we've done is more or less one fourth of all the process to get to the last result. And the first point is that in general, I guess this also Camillo mentioned to you last week, we know no way to claim that a minimal current, a minimized current, is a priori a graph. So there is no graphicality in the representation of the minimizing current. So one of the key points, so now it's K, so general theory for area minimizing currents, integral currents. So the first point, which I guess already Camillo mentioned to you, is that, I mean, we know no way to say a priori if a minimizing, an area minimizing current is a graph of a function. So no a priori estimates to claim graphicality. If these words exist in English. So to claim that we have a graph in the end. No, we don't know. And for example, in codimension one, what Camillo showed you is that once you have the excess, which is small, you are a graph. But before getting to this conclusion that you are a graph, you have to argue via an approximation and then find the decay of the estimate and get all the regularity, basically, before seeing that you are a graph. So, I mean, for example, in codimension one, it's true. Minimizing currents is locally a graph where it is regular. So, except this singular points. But in general, there is no way to say this a priori. This one would simplify the theory a lot. And now, in codimension, in higher codimension, it's not known if actually they are graph or not, somehow. But we don't have counterexample. So this point here, which is, I mean, it may seem a kind of technical point. It's very important in all this theory of regularity. And what plays the role of this graphicality is an approximation result. So behind passing from this non-parametric case to the real one, we have always approximation result. So approximation theorems, which kind of destroy all of the things apparently, that we have done up to now. Because when we find a function u from omega into this space of q points, whose graph approximates our minimizing current t, this function u is not solving any equation. It's not the minimizer of any function, but it's just an approximate minimizer. And now let me say that this one is one of the key points which changing from codimension one to higher codimension. In higher codimension, at least for what concerns the study of the dimension of the singular sets, approximate minimizers are enough and they enjoy the same regularity properties. In higher codimension, it's not true. So you cannot just say, I'm solving a perturbation of my problem and then I get the same regularity. But you have always, in some sense, to refer in a kind of continuous, I mean, to the fact that you are actually an approximation of a real minimizer, of a nonlinear problem. So this one is kind of technical, but it's the link, the kind of the link between what we have seen in this class, in this class, and the case of minimizing currents. Another point which is very critical, and I mean, in my opinion, is the starting point of this nonlinear theory. Even if, I mean, to discuss this property, you pass first via a first approximation result, is what I called you the problem of the centering, so deconstruction of the center manifold, which was what I planned to do in the last part of the class, but I didn't have time. So deconstruction of these center leaves, which is somehow doing having the role of the average of the values. This one is a very problematic point in the theory. And the point is that, I mean, you have to match kind of a couple, two conditions which goes one against the other. One condition is that the center manifold is really to behave like an average. So let's call this center manifold M. Then we look at parametrization of, let's say, u, or let's call n, they are normal parametrization from the center manifold to this space of q points, such that the graph of n is similar to the current t. And what you need to have is that n is almost average zero from one end. So one condition is that the average of this map should be approximate zero. For which, I mean, you would like to take the exact average of the values. But they are not regular at all. In the case of harmonic function, the average was harmonic. It was very smooth. In this case, I mean, when you have a current, you don't even know if it is a graph. When you approximate with a graph, the graph is just Lipschitz. So a priori, this quantity is just Lipschitz. But you need to have the center manifold, that's the second condition, which enjoys some regularity. And exactly what we need in the proof is that the regularity of the center manifold is at least C3. So in our case, this average was analytic. So we had no problem in all the computation we did. In this nonlinear case, we have to match this regularity here. And now these two conditions are kind of deeply related with the approximation issue. So you have to approximate in such a way to achieve this. So all the standard approximation you find in the literature, I mean, were not enough to achieve these two conditions here. And what Amgren proved was a new approximation result with better estimates in order to achieve these two conditions. But that's not yet the end of the story. So another point is that in the general theory of minimizing currents, we don't know if in general we have uniqueness of blow-up. So we don't know, that's maybe the most famous problem in the field, which plays a role also in this context here. So, because you would like to say, I take a singular point of my current, which I mean, in principle may not be a graph or whatever, but I take a branch point there, I blow up, and I will end up with a deminimizing function. So this process is kind of behind, on the back of this process, there is the assumption that making the blow up, the usual blow up to this current, so now isotropic blow up, not the one we have done in our proof, but the real one, you get a plane. Maybe with multiplicity, but you get a plane. So this one is not known. There is a theorem always due to Andren. So, which says that up to a set of dimension at most m minus 3, there exists a blow up. So, but one blow up, which is a plane. So you have the set of points, you throw away set of dimension, which is still okay for your result because you don't see in your final result. And then you know that at that point, you may blow up your currents, and you know that in the set of blow-ups, you get a plane. But you don't know if that one is the only plane. So in particular, along the sequences, I mean, you may have this plane which is rotating. So all the things we have done, actually, so all this theory of the study of the singularity does not solve this problem of uniqueness of the blow-up. So you have somehow also to deal with this issue here, that when you parameterize your currents on infinitesimal scale, your reference plane may change. So the only thing that you are able to do is to perform this non-parametric analysis, not on entire balls, but on annuli. In C2, to be minimized, they meet on a point. Wait, the kind of the.
And you multiply
the cycle. Exactly. You decompose these irreducible components of your cards. And here, what you need to do is, in some sense, to cope with this problem, that you don't know if it is true or false that you have a unique touch plane. So what you do is actually you perform your analysis not on the entire ball, but just on an annuli. Just here. So here you may parameterize and make this analysis with the frequency functions and so on over your centered manifold. But then when you change, in order to have this tangent plane, which is flat, maybe you have to restrict to a much smaller class, which usually it's not comparable with this one, because otherwise the tangent plane will be unique. So then you have to jump to a new site of your to a new scale, and on that scale, I mean, in principle, you lost all the information about your currents. So what was happening from here to here? You don't know. And here there is in some sense, part of the analysis is to deal with this problem. So how can we understand what happens where we don't have a small excess? Because converging to a flat tangent plane is saying that basically we look at the scales where the excess is small. So how can we understand the scales where the excess is not small? And here comes another part of the theory, which is mainly related to the way to construct this center manifold, and which says that the only way for the excess not being small is that your current has to have a big diameter. And this one, I mean, it's something which, I mean, that's at least, I mean, it's the way In the work with Camillo, we understood the problem. And it's a phenomenon which goes, we call, after the work of Tristan Rivière, we call splitting before tilting. So tilting is a word which refers to the rotation of the tangent plane. So that the tangent plane may rotate. This we cannot exclude because we don't know if we have this kind of uniqueness. But before the tangent plane rotates, so before we pass from this blue scale where we know that the tangent plane is this, to this yellow one where maybe the tangent plane has tilt, has become this, before doing this, the different leaves of the currents has to separate. And this one is the splitting. So the current splits before being able to tilt the tangent plane. And this one is an a priori estimate, which is, it's kind of at the basis of understanding what happened passing to the right scale where you have this small excess. And it's kind of necessary because this middle annuli here, it's a black hole for us. So we don't know there what is happening to our current. And this estimate, analytically, for example, you see in the frequency functional analysis we have done. So I told you the only key information was that the frequency was bounded. And we got a monotonicity formula, which is saying that the frequency in all this interval is bounded by the frequency on the external radii. We would know the same on interior annuli, but we're saying that the frequency remains bounded in all of these starting radii, which are an infinite sequence. Why can we claim that the frequencies on these starting points is always bounded by the same constant? And then it's because of this. So this splitting means that the L2 norm is so big that the frequency was the energy, which is an excess, divided by the L2 norm. And this one is so big to maintain this quantity bounded. So this estimate is sure in some sense that we can start our analysis with the frequency function there. And then let me mention a last point before concluding. So in the case of the minimizing functions, we had this uniform convergence. So at singular points, once we rule out the problem of collapsing to zero or collapsing to a single leaves, singular point was remaining a singular point. But here it's not anymore true, maybe. We don't know, but it's not it's not so clear. And we have to show that in some sense we have the persistence of singularities in all of this process. And what is here the problem is that the current may be perfectly singular at this point. But then we use always an approximation of the current. And the approximation is done on a big set which is missing a set of positive measures. Small but positive measure. So it may perfectly be that our approximation is making this current there regular. So there is no way, in some sense, to claim that in the Lipschitz approximation. So at the beginning, when we start our analysis, we may preserve the singularities. So that's not true. What is true is that these singularities somehow are preserved in the limit of this approximation. So in the limit, if the approximation is quite good, then it has somehow to converge to a singular point there. But for this, you need another a priori estimate somehow telling this, because point-wise is not true. And it's not true even in the limit, point-wise. But what you may prove, and here there is kind of another argument in analysis that you find in many contexts, it's a capacitory argument. So the capacity is what you look at, the capacity of the singular set. You may conclude that what is preserved is the dimension of this singular set, but not the point-wise behavior of the singularities. So that's and this one is just to give you a kind of idea of the the difficulties that you have in transferring this theory to the case of minimal currents. So the analytical issues and the geometrical issues are the one I showed you. So you have the point of being forced to have a parametrization which has multiple values. You have the problem of the centering, that I mean you have to exclude that everything is getting regular in the limit. And then you have the problem of getting trivial blow-ups, which is this infinite order of contact, which is the frequency. Now, in the case of this linearized problem, everything is very clean. The formulas are clean. You don't have any troubles in the computation, and the theory is very elementary. When you try to export this to the case of the nonlinear problem, you have to deal with all these difficulties that I showed you very schematically in these 5 points. So if you don't have questions, I think my time is exactly over, and then I will stop here. And of course, I will remain at your disposal for questions or discussions afterwards.